Warning, this is Jake's first walkthrough of Katawa Shoujo, and has no idea what to expect. But upon saying that, some content may be inappropriate for kiddies.
Previously on Katawa Shoujo.
Where was I? Oh yes, vast feminine conspiracy. And she's got no legs!
And?
Even without a voice, Shizune is direct and brash, and Misha seems to get along with everyone. On the other hand, Lily is soft-spoken and relaxed, while Hanako seems to be the shyest girl I've ever met. Polar opposites. Is she eating with her feet? That is top! Like the color when you wake up and you know that you saw the meaning of life in your dream but can't remember it? What does that even mean? And you're naked. Happy day. You're right, the difference between us is like heaven and hell. Oh, snap, crackle, and pop! And it's not hard to guess which one you might represent. Oh, it's a tempest, it grows. The question of the day. Did Hanako indeed, was she truly looking for Lily, or did she just come to see me? Emmy whirls around with her eyes widened. Hisho? No, I'm just dying, it's okay.
And our story continues.
Hey everybody out there in YouTube land, Jake and One Man Band is back again playing more Katawa Shoujo. And last time we left off, I almost died again. So now it's going to be made up to us by Emmy making us lunch. That's the best way to make up almost killing someone. If you want to make it up to him, just make him lunch. It's awesome. Hey, hi Hisho. Great timing. I have super extra lunch today, as promised. Let's go upstairs. Alright. The stairway to the roof is a little dilapidated, but it's clearly been used recently. At the top of the stairs is a door, complete with missing padlock. I wonder who the intrepid individual was that remove the lock. That sentence is weird. Anyway, I wonder who removed the lock. Emmy shoves the door open and steps beaming into the sunlight. Suddenly, a tall, dark stranger appears out of nowhere, suddenly imposing in front of us. Emmy flinches back, almost falling down the stairs. We all know who that is. Who's that Pokemon?
Eek!
Hello.
Yipes! You scared me, Rin!
Wait, isn't she... Yes! We all know that! We got one that is missing arms, and one that is missing legs. Together, they make a full person.
Hello!
Noticing that Rin is speaking to me, Emmy looks curiously at me. You two know each other? Vaguely. Kind of awkward conversations, but whatever. I look confusingly at Emmy. She's that friend of yours? Rin has turned her gaze towards the clouds drifting above the school. I didn't know you knew this person, Emmy. ... The awkward silence lasts only a few seconds until Emmy lets out a tiny giggle, shrugging the coincidence off. I've invited Hisho for lunch. If you know him, that's just better. Oh, does this mean I don't get food? Or did you invite him for lunch without the lunch? Neither. I have food for three. Nice thinking. Rin, she's funny, but she's serious. It's very dry humor, and I love it. They walk to the other end of the roof while I stay at the clock tower for a while, taking in the atmosphere. There's nobody else but us here. I guess the roof is not as popular as it is in other schools. A few rundown benches and tables are scattered around the edges, perhaps in an attempt to make the roof look less desolate. I don't know about you, but I would go up on the roof, like, if that was the possibility at my school. Schools in the past stuff. The small pebbles covering the roof rattle beneath our feet. I peek through the chain-link fence to take a look at the school grounds and beyond. Students are strolling in pairs and groups around the quadrangular. The quad. We always just called it the quad at my school and at the cafeteria. A few delivery trucks are driving past the school towards the convenience store nearby. Somewhere, a watchdog barks at a passerby. Aw, did doggy. You should go get that dog. Somehow, when I look towards the town center, the small town feel strikes me very strongly, almost Pobbly? Man, they're just hitting me with all these complex words now. The heretic lifestyle of big metropolises seems so far away and foreign here. Nobody has to run to catch a bus like their life depends on it, or get their senses overloaded by the neon lights and traffic jams. I feel surprisingly optimistic about this new life of mine, looking at my new hometown, even if it's going to be mine for only one short year. Finding out about my illness and having to move away from home all came so suddenly, I hadn't had time to think how I'd feel about it. When I step out of the shadow of the clock tower to the open, I feel warmth touching my back. The sun shines from a perfectly clear cerulean sky. A cold breeze sweeping over the rooftop makes me shiver, but only briefly. The wind carries the scent of trees and flowers, not smog and car exhaust like it used to just a few weeks ago. That's why country air is so much better for you. Emmy settles on a bench with Rin in tow, produces one big and two small lunchboxes from her bag. Who's the big one for, I wonder? Come on, Hishio, what are you waiting for? I don't know, an invitation? She is beckoning me to join them, making room on the already small bench. I can sit on the ground, or, you know, whatever. Or we can all get close, be buddy-buddy. I seat myself in the corner of the bench to take as little space as possible. It's pretty cramped, but somehow all three of us fit on it. Impressive view. Emmy suppresses a giggle and places a lunchbox in front of Rin, and hands another lunchbox to me. Here you go, lunch, as promised. They both have green eyes. It's nice. Homemade, no less. I'm impressed. Wow, this looks really good. Are there any rice balls? There has to be rice balls. Thanks, I made them myself when I can. Conversation dies off as I set about the business of feeding myself. Taking a few bites, I glance up and notice Rin deftly opening the lunchbox and propping a fork full of food into her mouth, using only her feet. Like a boss! Even though I've seen it before, I can't help but to be impressed at her dexterity. It's also a reminder of the sort of place I am in right now. Will I ever get used to sights such as this? Maybe, maybe not. Doesn't really matter. I can't decide if getting used to such a thing would be a good thing or a bad thing either. Does getting used to this place mean that I'm giving up on being a normal person? Who wants to be normal? Normal isn't fun. Or does it just mean that I'm becoming more understanding about those around me? I'm distracted from my thoughts by the sight of Emmy tearing into her lunchbox as if it had insulted her ancestors. You seem pretty hungry. Emmy looks up, mouth half full, and swallows before nodding. My morning run always works up an appetite. Duh. Which is great, because then I burn through lunch pretty quickly. She probably has the metabolism of a hummingbird. Help me keep my girlish figure. What would happen if you'd lose it when you become a man? I very nearly choke on my lunch trying not to laugh. It's a figure of speech. Does your figure have to run in the mornings too? Do you always talk like this? Talk like what? Like what? I think that answers my question. Or never mind. So, I struggle to think of small talk and settle on the obvious question. How did you two meet? Ooh, yay, story time. Rin seems content to let Emmy answer the question. Someone in the living department thought that we'd complement each other well, so we were assigned rooms next to one another. Complement each other? One has arms, one has legs. Like shoes and a suit. Huh? Emmy giggles at my confusion. Put us together and we've got all our limbs, get it? That's what I've been saying! Ah. So I started helping Rin get ready in the mornings, and that was that. I mean, you can't help someone get dressed every morning and not get along. I see. Rin chooses this moment to interject. I have trouble with shirts. I would imagine so. Right, that seems fairly obvious. Really? Kind of. I mean, you kind of just have nubs, not really hands. This isn't helping, but at least Emmy seems to find the whole thing funny. That combined with the fact that Rin is generously curious makes me feel slightly better and yet confused. I mean, you've got no arms. So, putting on a shirt seems like one of those things that would be difficult. And so with typing. Nah, you could probably use your feet to type. You know what? I'm going to just stop talking now. It'll save me a lot of trouble in the long run. Rin nods in what I suspect is meant to be a sage manner. I see. The conversation dies as I turn my attention back to my lunch. It's really quite good. Emmy finishes her lunch first and makes a contented noise. Ah, that was good. And I'm getting hungry just reading this. As she brushes herself with... As she busies herself with cleaning up her lunch, Rin speaks up. I'm thirsty. Oh, I almost forgot about that. Sorry. With a flourish, she reaches into her bag and removes a trio of juice boxes. Yes! Yes! Juice! So much better than water. She tosses me one that appears to be cranberry juice, one to Rin that appears to be some kind of strawberry milk, complete with pink color scheme, and keeps a equally pink box of some kind of fruit punch for herself. Now, when she throws it to Rin, does Rin catch it, like, in her lap? Because she doesn't have hands. So, you know, whatever. Rin dexterity stabs her straw through the top of the box and begins to drink. Like a boss! I'm once again impressed by how flexible she is, but this time I keep my comment to myself. Somehow I don't think either Emmy or Rin are the sort of people to think twice about the way they work around their particular disabilities. Rin especially so. Indeed, she gives off the impersonation of being entirely awkward, aware that she's missing any limbs at all. Whether or not that's a conscious decision is another matter. I am honestly not sure. So, Hisho, how do you like it up here? It's nice. It's quite nice, just like I said. I can read this guy's mind before he says anything. Actually, I like high places, for the view. Thanks for inviting me up here. And for the lunch, too. Emmy grins a 1,000-watt grin, pleased by my response, I suppose. No problem. Feel free to eat with us next time, too, okay? I won't make a lunch, but you can bring your own up here. No lunch service? I don't know. Ooh, he's growing a sense of humor. Very nice. Emmy looks mocked, offended. Trying to take advantage of my good nature? Maybe. The nerve. She giggles. Well, if that's your answer, I guess Rin and I will just keep eating lunch all alone. Ah, don't play the guilt trip with me! I am suddenly assaulted by the most heartrending puppy dog eyes I've ever seen as Emmy pouts. Them eyes! Stop it! You can end wars with those eyes! Kidding! I was kidding! I'd love to eat lunch up here again. Good location, and company's okay too. Okay, good. She's done doing the puppy dog eyes. I wasn't sure if I could handle that any longer. Emmy frowns a bit at my declaration of okay, but seems happy enough that I've accepted her invitation. I guess this makes us friends now. Yay! Making lots of friends! Or at least acquaintances. Nah, they're your friends. The lunch bell rings, signaling to return downstairs. I don't know about you, but that lunch was like, what, 5 minutes? Rin, you didn't finish your lunch again. I wasn't that hungry. If you don't eat more, you're going to fade away. Rin shrugs as if this is an acceptable risk. Come on, we'd better get going. The three of us head downstairs together. The afternoon class passes. Once again, I find myself without a plan for something to do after school. Dude, let's go hang out with Kenji. Maybe. Could be fun. Don't know. So I head to the library to return a couple of books I've finished reading that we've obviously done off screen. Walking inside, I see that there are about as many students here as there were on Tuesday. All the more evident that the almost total silence enveloping the room. So, back on Tuesday, that was like, what, episode 5? 7? Something like that? I don't know. Oh, as I dropped the books I borrowed onto the return slot on the counter, Yuko suddenly pops up from behind it, quite startled from the banging they made as they hit the trolley next to her. Ah, give me a heart attack, why don't you? Oh, sorry, Yuko. Didn't mean to startle you. No, it's fine. It happens a lot. I'm used to it by now. Can I help you? Maybe, depends on what I'm looking for. It's okay, I think I know where everything is. Thanks anyway. I suppose I'll grab another book or two while I'm here. There's not much else to do, and after reading so much during my stay in the hospital, it's become a hard habit to break. Dude, you should totally, pick up Art of War. It's an amazing book. I wander down to the fiction section, or fiction, you know, fiction's cool, section towards the back of the library, scanning the bookshelves for anything that catches my eye. And as I do, I look over to the corner where Hanako had been the last time I was here, not really expecting anything to come of it. But she's right there. Like always. Yay! More friend time! Surprisingly, though, she's there, absorbed completely into a fairly thick book. I decide against intruding on her like last time and get back to finding reading material. Okay, yeah, sure, being considerate. I don't care. After an indiscriminable amount of time spent pursuing the aisles, I finally decide on a couple of books and get to slide them off the shelf. With a minimum of fuss, I quickly walk over to the counter, check out my books, and pop them into my bag as I walk out. By the time I leave the main building, sunset isn't far away. A small trickle of students remain, but the majority have left, presumably to their homes and dorms. Well, this day went surprisingly quick. Feeling utterly drained, I head to my room to read the books I borrowed. There's been enough action and excitement for one day already. The first is Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. Now, is that different from just Alice in Wonderland? Because I know Lewis Carroll wrote Alice in Wonderland and then Through the Looking Glass, which is both about Wonderland, but... I don't know. I know the story, of course, but I have actually never read the original book. Then I guess it is the original book. It's just as trippy as I remember the story to be, with the wacky characters and nonsense plot. I start thinking of myself as some kind of Alice, too, heedlessly tumbling down the rabbit hole into this cripple wonderland. Oh, yeah, kinda. Okay, that's a rather strong expression. Still, the isolated location and the overt way the school accommodates to absolute everything is unsettling. It is like another world. I wonder why I can't shake the feeling of being an outsider like Alice, despite most everyone being so hospitable and friendly with me. Dude, it's just the way you think. If you change the way you think, you won't be an outsider anymore. Turning another page, my mind starts to drifting further away from the book. It's quiet. I can hear my heartbeat thumping against the fabric of my sheets. For some reason, it makes me feel really bad, like it has since the time in the forest with Iwanako. Like I was locked in a cage with something nasty and scary. Don't fear your heart. Heart is where your love lives. I put the book down for a while and stare at the ceiling, taking my time to shake off the feeling. 200 pages later, I fall asleep. 200 pages, like a boss! And cue the boo doo 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 doo. Now I wonder, is that his dream? Where he just thinks of a heart? That's Katawa Shoujo? Saturday morning session. Oh, it's a boarding school, so. And it's also in Japan, so they probably have school. Shut up. man, I live in the United States, so. I just went to school Monday for Friday. Anyway, I'm gonna end this episode here. Like and favor if you've enjoyed, subscribe, of course, and, I guess I'll see you guys next time. Hopefully, we'll start making some more progress, because so far I think we're still in the introductory phase. But hey, this thing is awesome and I love it, so I'll see you guys next time. Yeah. Bullseye.